Spaar ons niet, Godzilla. Vernietig wat je aantreft. Laat ons opnieuw beginnen. Trap ons maar kapot.
Wie is er thuis in Den Haag hier? Wie? Oké. De anderen niet. Ik ook niet. Bijzondere stad. Aparte stad. Ik was gisteren in het Mauritshuis. En toen dacht ik aan dit stuk. Whose house is this? Whose night keeps out the light in here? Say, who owns this house? It's not mine. I dreamt another, sweeter, brighter, with a view of lakes crossed in painted boats, of fields wide as arms open for me. This house is strange. Its shadows lie. Say, tell me, why does the lock fit my key? Het komt uit Home, uit 2012, van Toni Morrison, mijn literaire heldin. De grote denker waarover ik dit najaar een boek publiceer. En zelf had ik een ander fragment gekozen uit haar oeuvre, als ik eerlijk ben, waarover later meer. Home is wat mij betreft niet per se haar beste boek. En de tekst die ik zo net las, is niet per se haar beste metafoor of uitspraak. Doch de laatste zinnen inspireerden me wel. This house is strange. Its shadows lie. Say, tell me, why does its lock fit my key? Toni Morrison sprak net zo mooi en krachtig als ze schreef. Daarom zoek ik haar essentie niet alleen in haar boeken, maar ook in de vele interviews en de 3-4 documentaires over haar leven en legacy. En de grote favoriet, waarvan ik de korte versie maandelijks bekijk, is een interview door Jana Wendt. Dit interview helpt mij vooral precies te duiden hoe subtiel witte superioriteit werkt. Wel, niet werkt. Toen wint Toni Morrison vroeg when she would incorporate white lives into her books in a substantial way, sloeg Morrison terug met een pittig antwoord. You can't understand how powerfully racist that question is, can't you? Stelde Morrison. Can you? You could never ask a white author, when are you going to write about black people? Whether he did or not. Or she did or not. Even the inquiry comes from a position of being in the center. Hoe vaak ik dit bewuste korte fragment van het interview door Jana Wendt niet bekeken, herbekeken, herzien en geanalyseerd heb, ik denk zeker wel 150 keer minstens, niet overdreven. En bij het schrijven van mijn bundel Echo zeker 200 keer. En in hetzelfde gesprek is er het moment in het interview wanneer Morrison het vuur in haar mond lijkt te doven door een slok water te nemen, haar blik vlammen spuugt, maar zij toch haar kalme, beheerste zelf blijft en dan zegt: Being an African-American writer is sort of like being a Russian writer who writes about Russia, in Russia, for Russians, and the fact that it gets translated and read by other people is a benefit, a plus. But he's not obliged to ever consider writing about French people or Americans. En daarna sluit ze af met een stelling die ik dagelijks als een mantra herhaal, omdat ik echt geloof dat taal de werkelijkheid vormt. I stood at the border, stood at the edge, and claimed it as central. And let the rest of the world move over to where I was. Daar spreekt mijn grootste leraar ooit. Het was niet enkel Jana Wendt. Ik heb het meerdere keren zien gebeuren dat Toni Morrison door witte interviewers gevraagd werd wanneer ze nou eindelijk ook eens over witte mensen zou gaan schrijven. Soms roemde een recensent haar talent, maar dan kwam dat toch achteraan dat ze zich niet zou kunnen blijven beperken tot het provinciaalse zwarte leven dat in haar boeken zoveel ruimte kreeg. Zegt u mij, hoe vaak wordt witte toonaangevende schrijvers, mannen en vrouwen, de vraag gesteld wanneer ze eens over zwarte mensen gaan schrijven? Laat staan dat die vraag ooit aan een andere Nobelprijswinnaar werd gesteld. Dit fenomeen heet witte suprematie. Witte centrering. De witte blik. En de dominantie van die centrering maakt dat we gewend zijn dat het altijd en overal over witte mensen gaat. De bepalende stuwing van het dominante narratief, de master narrative, zoals Morrison het zelf noemt, is de basis van ons, van het Eurocentrische kanon en het curriculum. Van daaruit wordt gerecenseerd, van daaruit wordt kwaliteit bepaald, van daaruit wordt gekozen en besloten wie wel en wie niet. Toen ik mijn eerste essay over Toni Morrison schreef voor een blad dat voornamelijk recensies over boeken deelt, werd mij door de redactie aanvankelijk gevraagd het perspectief aan te passen. Het moest meer een boekrecensie worden, zoals die gebruikelijk verschenen in dat blad, in de gids. En meteen daarna, meteen nadat de erudite witte redacteur het me gevraagd had, voelde ik een enorme weerstand in mij opkomen. Het was geen gekke vraag, hè, die ze me stelde. Ik wist natuurlijk zelf ook wel dat ik geen gebruikelijke vorm gekozen had bij het schrijven van dit stuk. Maar de emoties en de weerstand die ik voelde, stapelden zich op als een bakstenen muur. Na een gesprek en een paar keer kort heen en weer mailen, wist ik zeker, echt heel erg zeker, dat ik dat aanpassen niet wilde. In mijn notitieboek schreef ik: de aanpassing die hun vorm van me vraagt, druist totaal in tegen de drijfveer van waaruit ik mijn essay over Toni Morrison schreef. Ik besloot het stuk niet te verkopen en een diepe opluchting maakte zich van mijn meester. De jonge redacteur van het blad reageerde niet met witte fragiliteit, dus ik voelde me vrij genoeg haar te kunnen vertellen dat het precies hierover ging. Dat dit was wat me zo raakte. Dit in het werk van Morrison. Het niet wijken. Het niet aanpassen aan. Het zich niet willen vormen naar de dominante norm. Toni Morrison maakte ruimte voor mijn emotie en verdriet. En toen ik ophing, was ik een betere schrijver dan voor het gesprek. Al die boeken die nog in mij groeien, waar starten ze? Waar houden ze op? Als het huis op mijn sleutel past, maar mijn sleutel schiet tekort, blijkt bij de eerste, tweede, derde poging het huis te betreden, binnen te gaan, gebied toe te eigenen, blijkt dat het niet werkt. Ik zeg van mij, maar al snel blijkt dat dat helemaal niet zo is. Is dat dan waar ik wil zijn? Sommige mensen hebben van die sleutels die alle deuren open krijgen. Een loper heet dat toch? Toch? Ik heb geen loper. Ik ben geen loper. Omdat. Let wel, het was ook nooit mijn ambitie om een loper te zijn. Al lijkt het me soms eerlijk een extreem aantrekkelijke kwaliteit. Stel je voor dat je alle deuren open krijgt. Maar een loper, in mijn taal, het Vlaams, betekent of klinkt loper bijna hetzelfde als een druiper. Of een sluiper. Ik geloof dat ik dan toch liever een breekijzer ben. Alhoewel, ik denk dat er nooit een baby geboren is die al prenataal besloot een breekijzer te worden, een breekijzer te zijn. Ik ben een breekijzer en deuren openbreken, er zijn leukere dingen om te doen. Maar iemand moet het doen, toch? Iemand moet het willen. Een cultuur van angst en onverdraagzaamheid maakt dat mensen besluiten poortwachters te zijn. Zij die besluiten wie erin komt en wie niet. Zij die zowel toegang hebben tot de sleutel en het slot. Hij wel. Zij niet. Het wel, hij niet. This house is strange. Its shadows lie. Say, tell me, why does its lock fit my key? Soms droom ik dat ik door de grote kunstpaleizen dwaal. Het Louvre, het Prado, het MoMA. Reina Sofia laatst. Mauritshuis gisteren. Soms droom ik dat en in mijn droom hangen de muren dan vol met mensen die op mij lijken. In mijn droom beleef ik die luxe. Iets wat me in mijn dagelijks leven amper, ja, wat ik me amper in kan beelden. Ik probeer te bedenken hoe dat voelen moet. Die constante herkenning dat de muren in de musea volhangen met mensen die op je lijken. Dat de reclames op tv gevuld zijn met nog meer mensen die op je lijken. Dat de films, de series, de boeken, het hele narratief bevolkt is met mensen die op je lijken. Dat je dagelijkse leven bestaat uit één en al spiegeling. Zo van, hey, kijk daar. Dan ik. Bevestigend lijkt me dat alles een spiegel is. Dat het altijd over jou gaat, wauw. Die vanzelfsprekendheid, die is, denk ik, beeld ik me dan in, zo vanzelfsprekend dat je er nooit bij stil hoeft te staan. Luxe lijkt me dat. Als een warm bad met een dikke laag schuim van rituals. Een spiegeling die je altijd en immer ten deel valt. En die zo vanzelfsprekend is dat je het niet eens hoeft te zien. Ik ben daar best jaloers op, ja. Dat je daar nooit over hoeft na te denken. Wauw, het toppunt van privilege. It is, punt. En weet je dat er mensen zijn hier en nu die zich beledigd voelen dat ik dat woord gebruik. Want zij hebben ook een moeilijke jeugd gehad. Of waren niet bepaald met een gouden paplepel in de mond geboren. Maar daarover heb ik het niet eens, hè, als ik het over privilege heb. Want tot op bepaalde hoogte heb ik ook privilege. En ik heb totaal geen moeite om dat toe te geven en om dat te zien. Maar er is altijd baas boven baas. Stel dat ik zou kunnen verdwalen in een kanon die altijd over mij en mijn mensen zou gaan. Stel je voor dat de mensen op foto's en de schilderijen op de muren van alle grote en kleine musea mij en mijn geschiedenis weerspiegelen. Stel dat het melkwitte, haast doorschijnende vel van de meisjes van Vermeer opeens in de tint van mijn confronterende zwart zou zijn. Dat de zittende vrouw aan het virginaal een zittende vrouw met een kora zou zijn. Voor wie eventueel onbekend is met de kora, het is een Afrikaanse harp. Ja, stel je voor dat het virginaal gewoon een West-Afrikaanse kora met 21 snaren zou zijn of een djembe met een kersvers opgespannen vel. Dat haar wangen niet roze-rood geverfd zijn om een blos te suggereren, maar dat haar afro strak gevlochten is in flinterdunne Senegalese cornrows of dat ze een kroon heeft van kroes, vrij krollende lokken of getwiste babylocks, zoals de mijne, kruldefinitie 4B of 4C. Stel dat het centrum niet bij jullie zou liggen, witte mensen, maar bij ons. Stel je voor, u de sleutel, ik het slot.
Hey everyone, in the Hague, or as some used to refer to it, the widow of the Dutch East Indies, present day Indonesia. I'm going to read a couple of poems for you out of my poetry book, Manual for the Displaced, Handleiding voor Ontheemden, which will be published next year. And it's sort of dedicated to all the in-betweeners, so the people that are in between histories, in between generations, in between countries and flags, in between homes, in between houses. Nieuwjaarsgebed. Dit lichaam veranderde al zo vaak van eigenaar. Ik blaas het stof uit de schedel. Maak steeds opnieuw mijn thuis achter dezelfde oude muren. Uren zullen door me heen bewegen. Echo's van kinderliedjes, marcherende soldaten. Sporen van gestolde woorden. Koester de huid, de krassen. Dat is alles. Orden de botten van je dierbaren. In de geest van één. Ik bouwde een altaar voor het achtergelaten huis. De muren omsluiten, het grootste deel van mij. Een pretpark met miniatuurmolentjes, plastic tulpen en een goudgespoten VOC-kanon. De muren versperren, een minderheid in mij. De naam van een oermoeder, een huid die snel bruin wordt. Onopgegraven lichamen. 2. Mijn dromen bevatten monumenten. Van een generaal die salueert naar het weeskind. Van bomen met luchtwortels. Uitlopers van inkt op gebleekte bankbiljetten. En hoe verder oostwaarts je reist, hoe ouder en viezer dat geld wordt. Kijk, dit is het museum van onthoofde heersers. Sukarno's hoofd van een envelop afgestoomd. Het archief van verdwenen geuren, kamfer en een rozenkransje. De galerie van uitgewiste straatnamen. Inmiddels staat er een Pertamina tankstation. Vriendschappen, sommige verlopen of geperforeerd. Gezichten die ik heb overgeschilderd in zwart of wit, sommige nog in uniform. Ik verdrijf ze tijdens het middaggebed. En wek hen 's avonds tot leven met exotisch ogende dansen. En soms voel ik een hand op mijn schouder. Het is makkelijker om te lopen over de doden dan om hun verhalen mee te dragen. Zie mij eens mijn best doen om hier thuis te zijn. Ik spreek de klanken zo correct mogelijk uit. Ik kijk niemand in de ogen als ik groet. Ik heb een batik-shirt dat complimentjes krijgt. Ik ben de Insta-mascotte, 2 koppen groter. Ik eet op straat met de locals mee. Ik lepel voldoende sambal op mijn bord. Spoel mijn reet af met het flesje. Ik kleur de witte rijst bij met ketchup. Mijn genen bakken mee met de zon. Ik ben best stoer op die scooter. Ik ben hier al lang genoeg. Zie mij eens mijn best doen om hier thuis te zijn. Ik spreek de woorden zo correct mogelijk uit. Ik kijk je strak aan in de ogen als ik groet. Ik heb een wintertrui die complimentjes krijgt. Ik ben jullie voetbalvriendje, 2 koppen kleiner. Ik eet andijvie met de plaatselijke bewoners. Ik schep voldoende jus in het kuiltje. Ik veeg zittend mijn reet af met een rol schuurpapier. Ik prak aardappels dwars door de groente heen. Mijn genen bleken mee in de sneeuw. Ik ben best stoer op die racefiets. Ik ben hier al lang genoeg. And this is the closing part of the book. De waringinboom houdt hier de wacht. Boven op de stadsheuvel. Hoger dan de zendmast komen kan. Luchtwortels sidderen als elektriciteitsdraden. Een zee van muntgeld stort uit de gele lucht. Ik hoor de straten rinkelen. Houd mijn mond wijd open. Een roestkleur wurmt zich uit mijn mouwen. Blijft aan mijn vingertoppen kleven. Ik lik het roet van de varens. Ammoniak van bescheten stambeelden. Oorlogshelden met hun dichtgeknoopte borden. Op hun schoongespoelde paarden. Ik voel hoe een kogeltje rolt over mijn voorhoofd, langs mijn neusschans, van bovenlip naar kin, waar het even blijft hangen, zich volzuigt en naar beneden valt, op de grond spat met een inslag. Hummers glijden voorbij als strijkijzers. Hun wielen stomen paden onder mijn voeten door. Ik sta hier goed. Ik heb er vrede mee. De namen voor orkanen raken uitgeput. 2. De wind rammelt aan mijn benen. Als een ongedurige peuter. Ik probeer dit landschap geen aandacht te geven. Vind een stukje grond om naar te kijken. Rijen witte kruisen stuiven op uit het gras. Het zonlicht lacht ze als tanden bloot. Dit is waar ze rotten, denk ik bij mezelf. De samengeharkte botten van soldaten, griffiers, spoorwegbeamtes, plantagehouders. En eronder nog veel oudere botten. Zij die hun rug voor hun kromden. De grond herinnert zich niets. Zij heeft hen al lang verteerd. Regen en vliegzand hebben hun namen uit het steen gespoeld. De kuilen spiegelspottend nog wat water op. Wat kom ik hier doen? Wat dacht ik hier te voelen dan? En toch, mijn lichaam kent de gebaren, mijn huid de zon, mijn mond de smaak. Ik sta hier met gebogen tenen op de zwarte grond waar elke dag iets nieuws. De zwarte grond waar elke dag iets feller groens uitgroeit. De wind kerft een voorvader in mijn gezicht. Een masker van mahonie dat zich achter mijn kaken hecht. Een zoute klank maakt zich meester van mijn keel, nestelt zich in de groef van mijn tong. Muren schuiven over elkaar en trekken een landschap open. Licht van een eeuw eerder strijkt als een kwast over het zandpaadje. Soms kun je even horen wat je al een leven lang roept. Soms maak je zomaar een beweging die iemand generaties eerder al in je pezen sleept. Diep onder mij verschuiven aardplaten. Wordt met bakken gloeiend puin gesmeten. Kolkt een vloeibare zon die massa's lava uitbraakt. Ik voel alleen het trillen. Dankjewel.
So I'm not here to talk about my own work. I'm here to honor the work of Rebecca Solnit. My name is Roanne van Voorst. I'm an anthropologist. I'm a writer. I'm also a granddaughter. And 10 years ago, my grandmother gave me a book, Men Explain Things to Me, by Rebecca Solnit. It's a book that introduced the word mansplaining to society. And she knew that word very well. My grandmother was a very smart, ambitious woman. A woman that wanted to study, she couldn't. She had to marry a man who she didn't like. She had 7 babies. She didn't really like that life, and when she grew older, she fled, I could say, to Canada, to Rome, did all the things secretly. She's still ambitious. She's 98 now. She refuses to get the vaccinations because she's very concerned about the long-term consequences. But when I told her that I got to interview Rebecca Solnit, she was extremely happy. And Rebecca is a sharp thinker. We spoke about her newest book, or one of her newer books, called Recollections of My Non-Existence. And as most of her books are, they're confrontational. They cause friction. Some people like it, some people don't like it. For me, it was a bit of both. It taught me, amidst the whole Me Too discussion, that probably the discussion shouldn't only be about the bad man, but also about all the women that remained silent for so long. And she gives small examples, like the one guy sitting in a bus taking up too much space, and then she becoming very small, and then wondering in the book, why have I always done this my whole life? And it was weird for me, as someone who's younger than she, and much younger than my grandmother, that I still recognize so much of it, and that I still found it almost hard to read. So we're going to watch a little part of the interview that we did. It's about 13 minutes. After the festival, it will become public on the online channels of Writers Unlimited and YouTube. And I hope you get to see it, because her opinions really do make us think, if only for my grandmother. Have fun.
But I'll start with a passage.
Please do.
A friend gave me a desk not long after I moved into the apartment, a woman's small writing desk or vanity, the one I am writing on now. It's a dainty Victorian piece of furniture with 4 narrow drawers, 2 on each side, and a broader central drawer above the bay in which the sitter's legs go, and various kinds of ornamentation, dowled legs, each with a knob like a knee, knobby ornaments, scallops on the bottom of the drawers, drawer pulls like tassels or teardrops. There are 2 pairs of legs on the front, 2 on the back, set beneath the side drawers. Despite all the frills, the old desk is fundamentally sturdy, an eight-legged beast of burden whose back has carried many things over the decades, or two beasts of burden side by side, yoked together by the desktop. The desk has moved with me three times. It's a surface on which I've written millions of words, more than 20 books, reviews, essays, love letters, several thousand emails to my friend Tina during the years of our near daily epistolatory exchange, a few hundred thousand other emails, some eulogies and obituaries, including those of both of my parents, a desk at which I did the homework of a student and then a teacher, a portal onto the world and my platform for reaching out and diving inward. A year or so before she gave me the desk, my friend was stabbed 15 times by an ex-boyfriend to punish her for leaving him. She almost bled to death. She had emergency transfusions. She was left with long scars all over her body, which I saw then without response, because whatever capacity to feel had been muffled, maybe, when I got habituated to violence at home, maybe because it was something we were supposed to take in stride and be nonchalant about, back when few of us had language to talk about such violence or an audience ready to listen. She survived. She was blamed for what happened, as victims often were then. There were no legal consequences for the would-be murderer. She moved far from where it happened. She worked for a single mother who was evicted and who gave her the desk in lieu of wages, and then she gave it to me. She moved on, and we lost touch for many years, then reestablished it, and she told me the full story, a story that could make your heart catch fire and the world freeze over. Someone tried to silence her. Then she gave me a platform for my voice. Now I wonder if everything I have ever written is a counterweight to that attempt to reduce a young woman to nothing. All of it has literally arisen from the foundation.
This year's theme of the festival is called Whose House Is This? And essentially it's all about, I guess, feeling at home in the world or in a specific location. It's about feeling safe, but also about having the room or the ability to have a voice or to express that voice. And I guess that this little fragment for me or for us, it gave all of those perspectives. It's you taking the stage by using the desk to write letters, but also writing a book about female abuse or about females being erased from society. And it's a desk of a woman who actually had that happen to her. Does that resonate or make sense? Do you?
Absolutely. And the remarkable thing is I've known my friend's story since I was 19, when, you know, before she gave me the desk. And I've had that desk all these years, more than 40 now. And I never really thought about the fact that everything I'd ever written had been written on this desk. And I write in bed and easy chairs and airplanes and every place else, but mostly at that desk. And to think that everything I'd ever written was just trying my own struggle to have a voice, to be heard in the world, to be allowed to be a participant. In a world that didn't really want young women to speak up, to have opinions, to demand full participation, to think that it all sprung from this gift from a woman a man tried to annihilate. But of course, we know that most of the violence women face is from intimate partners, is in the home. And so even there, women aren't safe, though mostly we're cautioned to stay home, to not go out in the streets, to not participate in the world, to not have voices, to not show up. And this book is called Recollections of My Non-Existence because it's both about all the ways women, particularly young women, face erasure, annihilation, silencing, and all the ways we're told to erase, annihilate, silence ourselves for safety. If you don't show up, nobody will try and eliminate you. Yeah. So yeah, and then of course the larger question that very much relates to your festival is, what does it mean to be at home in the world? Whose world is this? Who decides who participates, and that I think is feminism's central question in some way.
Allow me, if you want, to read a quote from Home by Toni Morrison, because it inspired the festival's theme. And it says, "Whose house is this? Whose night keeps out the light in here? Say, who owns this house? It's not mine. I dreamed another, sweeter, brighter, with a view of lakes crossed in paint boats, of fields wide as arms open for me. This house is strange. Its shadows lie. Say, tell me, why does its lock fit my key?" Does that resonate with you at all?
I still have so much more agency in my life than my mother and grandmother and on through all the generations. One of the things I'm looking for in my work on climate, as well as feminism and all other kind of the movements I care about, is how can we say things have changed a lot for the better, but not nearly enough. We're in the middle of a process in which we've had some victories, whether it's race, something Toni Morrison was one of our great voices on, you know, or gender, and she was very intersectional, you know, or economic justice, climate justice. Will there be room for young people in a future if we don't make the transition from fossil fuels? Will there be room for all the species? You know, what room do we lose to sea level rise? There's so many ways you can think about that. How do we recognize the earth as a home that everyone has the right to be in? You know, it could go in so many directions. Yeah. But yeah, I think that's a beautiful framework. And I think it also brings up women being stuck at home because the world is not their home. And that question for me of what does it mean to be at home in the world, to feel that the university, the workplace, the streets, the public arena, the Congress, the courts should be places where you're also at home, where people at like you have equal standing. And of course, this could apply to, you know, people of color, you know, Muslims, trans people, people who are a minority by gender or religion or race, et cetera, disabled people. Yeah. How do we make a world in which everybody's welcome, a world of horizontality and egalitarianism? Well, I wanted to use my own story, not because I felt like I had exceptional experiences, but because I thought I had very ordinary experiences. There have been a number of memoirs in the United States that are about a woman to whom something exceptionally terrible has happened, a murder attempt, a gang rape, extremely violent spouse. And I felt that my experience was actually very ordinary. And because of that, I could say something different, which is that all women live in a world in which men want, some men, of course, not all, but some men want to rape her, assault her, degrade her, deny her rights, maybe take her life, that this is celebrated, fetishized, romanticized in rock videos, songs, movies, books, etc. And that to live in a world in which your annihilation is celebrated and given a very soft treatment does something to you. And I could say that because, you know, because my experience was so ordinary. And then also I was having both the very ordinary experience of voicelessness that I think is all but universal for young women, and my own particular trajectory in trying to have a public voice as a writer in a world in which most of the celebrated voices were still men, in which I was going to be told in a lot of different ways that I wasn't competent to speak, I didn't deserve to be heard, and wasn't at crucial moments, both in my professional and my personal life. So all that together was part of the book.
So the question, whose house is this, also relates to question the spaces that are dominated by the same groups, right, throughout history. And it reminded me of what you wrote about the gendering of the city, how almost all buildings and street signs are named after mostly white men. So what does it mean in terms of taking up space? And can you briefly tell us something about the subway map project that you did?
I can, and we just produced a London tube map that's a sister to our New York map. The New York Atlas has a map in it called City of Women, where we renamed every subway stop in New York, there's more than 400, after a notable woman in New York paying attention to, you know, to race and rebels and the trans women in the Stonewall riots of 1969. Out at the great tennis courts on Long Island are Venus and Serena Williams, you know, Hannah Arendt and Susan Sontag and Grace Lee Boggs. But what was shocking to me, it wasn't until I made that map that I realized fully, not just that we live in a world of things named mostly after men, the dominant men, the kings and conquerors and generals and rich men, and, you know, mostly white men, of course, but that it really has an impact on you, because it was only then I did the thought experiment, what would have been like when I was a very young person to walk around in a world where lots of things were named after women,
were examples,
streets,
right?
Streets, yeah. And buildings, you know, cities and states themselves were named after women. And I think it would have opened up so much more possibility for me. I asked a group of students at Columbia University the same thing, and two young women of color had the most remarkable answers. One of them said, I have slouched my whole life. I would stand up straight on streets named after women like me. Another said, would a man dare to harass me on a street named after a great woman? I think that, you know, we often talk about these things in terms of, like, we should name schools after Rosa Parks, the great black civil rights hero, for little black girls. And we should, but we should also do it for little white boys. We should live in worlds that show us ourselves some of the time. And this is something I also write, because I grew up with a white male literary canon. Writers like Toni Morrison and James Baldwin were never really, like, pushed at me. I read almost, like, you know, there are very few women in my official education and very, very few people of color. So we need a world in which we see both mirrors and windows. We ourselves, whoever we are, reflected back. We need a world of coexistence for everybody. And so changing names is often seen as very decorative, but I think it reinforces a pretty deep sense of who matters, whose story is told, who our heroes are. I found that summer of Black Lives Matter 2 years ago, the taking down of so many statues of racists and of imperialists, of King Leopold, you know, in Belgium, and slave traders in Bristol. I love that it spread to Europe, and Columbus statues came down, as well as American Confederates and slave traders and things, and that new names are arising. And you look at it all happening, particularly in North America, and you see that an old civilization is giving way to a new one that will have new values, new heroes, new touchstones, new names. And it's happening, and it's very exciting.
So speaking of changing history, as a last question, if you could burn down one house or institution or power, so to speak, what would it be? And what would you build in return?
That invitation to arson is fun, but I think that it's not so much wholesale destruction as changing who's in charge. You don't burn down the Senate. You try and have, you know, a Senate that reflects the population. You don't
Fair
burn
point.
Down
the Senate.
Yeah, and so I'm not so much an arsonist as somebody who wants to change the cast in the stories. Although I do talk a lot. In journalism, we have a wonderful phrase in English, break the story, which usually means to, like, be the first person to tell a new story. You've exposed these crimes.
Yeah.
You know, you found this history, you've heard.
Show a new reality, yeah.
Yeah. And so it's a process of creative destruct, but I think of it also as like breaking the story that women are inherently inferior, the story that it's a democracy when everyone who speaks up is a white man, the story that, you know, these people are inherently superior, the story that gender is a simple set of two airtight binaries, the story that we need to burn fossil fuel and there is no alternative. The story that we can't make the transition, we need to. You know that breaking stories is also creative. So I don't want to burn things, but I do want to break them and break them open like an egg to let what's held back inside come forth. The new stories emerge. And I say in this book that I see myself as a breaker of some stories, a maker of others. And I could add to that also an amplifier of other people's stories that haven't been told. And my training was as a journalist, and going out and trying to hear and amplify those stories has been such a wonderful job, such a great vocation, and such an ongoing education for me. So I feel very lucky in what I do.
Thank you very much for this time and for all your work.
Thank you so much.
And thank you so much.
Thank you to everyone there for listening.
Thank you.
Thank you, feminism.
Hey y'all, how y'all doing today? How y'all doing today? All right, thank you. it's always a hard thing to go on right after musicians. I feel like I should be holding a guitar or something just to feel cooler. I can't play, but just for my own personal confidence. Before I read my own work, I'm going to read from The Prophet by Khalil Gibran. The way I found this was I have a friend who I used to jokingly call my spirit guide, and then she really became my spirit guide. She was like kind of that person who like gives me good advice and always kind of knew what I should kind of be doing. She got into energy work and sort of started, like, she's became a healer for real. And so one day she's like, oh, come to my house and we'll do like a, almost like tarot, but with like a book. And it involved, well, you had to get high first. I don't know if that was part of it or just, I think it was part of it. It felt like it was a part of it. And then you find a book and turn to a random page in it and read it. And I found this page from the Prophet, which I'll read now, and I'll give a little bit of context. And it makes sense given the sort of theme of this festival. Then a mason came forth and said, speak to us of houses. And he answered and said, build of your imaginings a bower in the wilderness ere you build a house within the city walls. For even as you have homecomings in your twilight, so has the wanderer in you, the ever distant and alone. Your house is your larger body. It grows in the sun and sleeps in the stillness of the night and is not dreamless. Does not your house dream, and dreaming leave the city for grove or hilltop? With that I could gather your houses into my hand and like a sower scatter them in forest and meadow. Would the valleys were your streets and the green paths your alleys, that you might seek one another through vineyards and come with the fragrance of the earth in your garments, but these things not yet be. In their fear, your forefathers gathered you too near together. And that fear shall endure a little longer. A little longer shall your city walls separate your hearths from your fields. And this part that's coming up next is the part that kind of really hit me. Because for a long time, I had kind of internalized this like, secret mission to return my family to a certain kind of space. I used to live in a big project in Queens called FREC City, and then we moved to this house in Rockland County, which is another place in New York. These are places in New York. And this house is where I had most of my really good memories. And as time passed, my mom's mental health sort of changed, and my dad's job situation was wavering up and down, and the house got foreclosed. We had to leave that house. Then we had to go to another apartment later on, and then we got evicted from that place. So there was a place, there was sort of this period of housing insecurity that sort of hardened something in me, and kind of, I think, why I'm a writer. And it's kind of why when I saw the theme, I felt like I would come here for this. And I was really, something changed in me, and I thought I had to get this house back. And so, again, that's where I was when I read this next part. And it sort of changed something in me and kind of gave me an important epiphany. And it reads, and tell me, people of Orphalese, what have you in these houses? And what is it that you guard with fastened doors? Have you peace, that quiet urge that reveals your power? Have you remembrances, the glimmering arches that span the summits of the mind? Have you beauty that leads the heart from things fashioned of wood and stone to the holy mountains? Tell me, have you these in your houses? Or have you only comfort and the lust for comfort, that stealthy thing which enters a house as a guest and then becomes a host and then a master? And so as you can maybe see, I was like, oh shit, like, my mind really changed. I sort of realized I had been sort of equivocating like this house space with happiness, with like love that had existed. And really, that's not what had been, that had been lost, but that wasn't the most important thing. What hurt me, what I was sad about, was the relationship between my parents changing, the anger that had sort of, was sort of maybe supported by this, these losses. But there's a version of this sort of life where We went to a smaller house, but became closer, became happier, became a little bit more tightly bound. But that's very rarely what happens because of so many of these institutions we have. And so I read that, and it changed my mind about things. And I realized I'd come a long way sort of thinking about the wrong thing. And it's like I thought basically, like, if the plumbing was better, everyone would love each other more. And I think there's a lot of ways we can trick ourselves into thinking that, or not even trick ourselves, I think capitalism forces us to think that way. And so many of our institutions force us to think that way. And a lot of my writing life has been seeing that and rewinding myself back. So that's my friend Kathleen Kansey, I just want to evoke her. She helped me find that out. And now I'm going to read a story from my book. As I said, it's a story that actually is one of the most true-to-life story in my book. A lot of people know me for like surreal or like sci-fi stuff. But this story is actually pretty much one-to-one something that happened. And I actually sometimes don't read it unless I feel like a really good vibe because it sort of represents what was a difficult time for me. But I also think now, having listened to some of these speakers today, I feel sort of like, and also maybe because my dad is now like passed, I feel more empowered to think about like the actual reason it's difficult is that so many of those situations came from his sort of treatment, and this is his anger and his sort of attitude towards especially my mom, but really all of us, and how if, like, that's like the unsaid thing in this, and I think a part of me always sort of remembers that, but not saying that feels like a disservice in this particular moment. And yeah, I just want to say I'm grateful to be in the space, I'm grateful for the vibes, I'm grateful for all these incredible artists who have allowed me to share a stage with you. It's really an honor, and I feel really blessed to get to do it, even if I can't play guitar at all. I'm going to read this very short story. It's called Things My Mother Said. It's about things my mother said. My mother's favorite thing to say to me was, "I am not your friend." She'd often say, "You are my firstborn son, my only son," as a reminder not to die. She loved saying as a way to keep me humble, "I didn't have a mother. You're lucky. You have a mother." When the TV went dark, my mother said, "Good, now you can read more." Then our house at the bottom of a hill lost all its life. Gas, water, electric. One day I came home to the warm smell of chicken and rice. I hadn't been able to steal a second burger at the cafeteria at school that day. My stomach whined. At home, the fridge had become a casket bearing nothing. The range and oven had become decorations meant to make a dying box look like a home. Hunger covered those days. "Where is this from?" I asked, already carving a healthy portion from a worn gray pot. My mother pretended she didn't hear me. She was studying the pages of her massive white Bible at the kitchen table. Wide sheets of light pressed through the window and draped her. She spent her days reading that big Bible. Its pages wore to film as her fingers fluttered from psalm to psalm. She'd be asleep by the splash of dusk. I, on the other hand, would be up for hours, trying to do homework by the blue glow of my cell phone, clinging to its light until it died. At night, hunger and I huddled together. I'd fall asleep thinking one day I would change everything. That afternoon, I ate the chicken and rice. It tasted like pepper and smoke. "How did you make this, Mom?" I asked again. She looked up from her Bible. "Aradie, pray over your food. Did you say your psalms today?" I ate the food quickly, greedily. I chewed the bones till they splintered in my mouth. Another thing my mother often said, "You are the best thing that ever happened to me." Later, when I was in the backyard, hesitant to return to the dying box as the sun dipped away, I found a patch of charred grass and a small circle of blackened stones and pebbles, an ash moon branded into a sea of wild green grass. I touched a gray rock partially blackened by flame to see if it was still hot. I felt proud and ashamed. For the record, I know I was lucky. I know I'm lucky. I don't think you're stupid. I know I'm not your friend. I hope you can be proud of me. Thank you, guys.
Ik hou nog.